हेलो फ्रेंड्स, सो वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू. माई सेल्फ नेहा गुप्ता, यू मेंटर फॉर करंट अफेयर्स. सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अ लॉट ऑफ इम्पॉर्टेंट क्वेश्चंस लाइक योर वर्ल्ड मलेरिया रिपोर्ट. सो अलॉन्ग विद दिस आई हैव अ लॉट ऑफ अदर क्वेश्चंस ऑल्सो. सो लेट्स बिगिन दिस वीडियो. बट बिफोर दैट, द इन्फॉर्मेशन फॉर यू ऑल इज दैट यू कैन डाउनलोड द PDF ऑफ दिस सेशन ऑन द टेलीग्राम चैनल एंड द लिंक ऑफ आवर चैनल इज इन डिस्क्रिप्शन बिलो. सो ऑन दैट नोट, लेट्स बिगिन विद आवर फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन. So, which country accounts for the highest estimated cases of malaria in the Southeast Asia region as per WHO's World Malaria Report 2021? So, India, Indonesia, Pakistan, Nepal, Myanmar are in the options, out of which India is the right answer. Okay. Now, what is the actual number of the cases and how much deaths has India reported? All of this I am going to discuss in the India's case. So what I have done here is that I have divided this entire World Malaria Report into two parts. First part is going to talk about the global scenario, and second part is going to talk about the India's case. Okay, so what is the situation of India? In the global scenario, we will look at the global cases as well as WHO's targets. What WHO has set for the countries in terms of malaria. In India's case, we will look at India and the world, the comparison between India and the world. We will look at India and the Southeast Asian region. So, also we will look at the initiatives that India has taken to eliminate malaria. So, all of this is here that we are going to discuss. So, I have just given you the brief introduction of the structure of this report so that you cannot get astray while I will be teaching you this report. Now, the next basic information that I want to give you about this report is that the number of estimated cases is different from the number of reported or confirmed cases. Okay, this topic will come when we discuss India and the Southeast Asia, but still, since this is the beginning of this report, so I like to share this basic information so that you can keep this distinction in your mind all the time while we will be discussing this report. So, estimated cases, basically, what is the real scenario? We all know that on the very real terms, we all know that malaria is spreading in India. India is one country that has a very high burden of malarial cases. Okay. On the other hand, how many cases are actually reported and how many cases are confirmed? So basically, these two are one and the same things. Okay. So how many malarial cases have been reported? That is the reported or confirmed case, or we can say that is the actual number that is available to the WHO who has prepared this report. Okay. So that was another basic thing. Now let's move into the global scenario. So here is the fact sheet, and guys, this fact sheet, I have tried my level best to summarize it to the very concise and precise points which can be helpful for you in your examination. Now, if you ask me to summarize this as well, so I'm sorry, I'm not going to do that because it is not in my capacity. How much more precise or summarized version do you want of this table? Okay, so this is something where you have to do a little of cramming work, but this is current affairs. We cannot ignore cramming or learning by rote when it comes to facts. Okay. However, if you try to understand the meaning or the story behind any kind of major news, then it becomes easier for us to memorize the facts. Now let's come back to this table. So the total number of deaths in 2020 is 627,000. The total malarial cases, 241 million. Okay, now let me tell you that both of these, total malarial cases as well as total number of deaths, both of these have increased in comparison to 2019, and clearly we can see why these two numbers have increased, because COVID-19 disrupted the entire progress, the entire value chain, or we can say, through which we were diagnosing the people who were affected with malaria as well as providing them with the treatment. So the entire chain was disrupted due to the COVID pandemic, as well as the healthcare resources that we had were all devoted to the COVID pandemic. Therefore, the achievements that we gained in different disease elimination programs were receded in 2020. And this is one of those examples. Okay, now coming to the third table or third block. So incidence of malaria, that means how many cases are there per 1,000 population, per 1,000 vulnerable population. So we have 59. This is the global fact. This is the global data. Okay. The most affected region is Africa. Now here you can yourself imagine how much drastic is this burden of malaria for Africa. Out of 241 million cases, 228 are alone from the African region. The six countries, all from Africa, account for 55% of all the global malarial cases. Okay, now here Nigeria accounts for 27%, Democratic Republic of Congo accounts for 12%, Uganda 5%, Mozambique 4%, Angola and Burkina Faso both are at 3.4%. Now guys, I know that there would be a question in your mind that do you need to memorize these numbers as well? No, only Nigeria would suffice, okay, and this number or this number, okay. So these numbers are important because whenever you want to write any kind of descriptive essay on such kind of thing, I don't think that directly there would be a question on this report, but still. Let's say, for example, if you have to write anything in order to highlight the progress made in African region towards elimination of malaria or any kind of communicable diseases, so you can cite these numbers directly. No need to go into the country-wise detail, okay? Now, next point here is that in 2021 only, two countries have been certified as malaria-free by WHO, and those countries are China and El Salvador. Now the next point that we are going to discuss here is the targets. So what are the targets of WHO for elimination of malaria by the year 2030? So first of all, you need to know that which report mentions these targets. So the report is this. Sorry. Global Technical Strategy for Malaria 2016 to 2030. This is the name of the report that lays out the targets for malaria elimination. So here you can clearly see the milestones and the targets, okay? So let's read them out one by one. And guys, if you can do memorize these targets, whenever you come across any targets of WHO in terms of communicable and non-communicable diseases, you are required to memorize those targets. Even though you know in your heart that these targets might not be asked in the examination directly, but still those targets are important for you because you can cite them in your descriptive answers, okay? So coming back to this target thing, first target is reducing malaria mortality rates globally compared with 2015. So 2015 has been taken as a baseline. So WHO seeks to eliminate the malaria mortality by 90% in comparison to 2015. Same is the case with incidence. So it is also going to be reduced by 90%. Eliminate malaria from countries in which malaria was transmitted in 2015. So here the target is 35 countries. Okay, so malaria would be eliminated in 35 countries by the year 2030. Prevent re-establishment of malaria in all countries that are malaria free. So re-establishment prevented. So this is the same thing reiterated here. So these are the targets for 2030. Now the milestones for 2020. So this reduction was 40%, and at least 10 countries were about to eliminate malaria, and re-establishment was about to be prevented. So now what does this report say regarding these milestones? So majority of the countries now have receded back on their progress, and they might not be able to achieve the 2030 targets. So this is what the report says. This is the overall outlook of the report in the context of these targets. Okay. Now I am going to talk about the Southeast Asia region as well. So let me just inform you here only that in the Southeast Asian region, if you exclude Indonesia, then majority of the countries have achieved these milestones of 2020. Okay. This also includes India. So these two targets have been achieved by the Southeast Asian countries except for Indonesia. Indonesia is the country that has seen a rise in the number of cases. So now we are going to jump to India scenario, where we will also discuss about the Southeast Asia region. But first, you need to understand. I think that you would be thinking that why is India counted in the Southeast Asian region, whereas India is a part of the South Asia. So if you had that question in your mind, a thumbs up for you all. And if you did not have it, so I hope that I have put it in your mind. So understand, why is the entire region called the Southeast Asian region, whereas geographically it is not the Southeast Asia? So here WHO has divided the world into six regions in, on the basis of its operations. So this is the WHO's demarcation of the Southeast Asian region, which includes Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Korea as well, Indonesia, Maldives, Myanmar, Nepal, Sri Lanka, Thailand, Timor-Leste. Now, you are not required to memorize this thing, okay, because this is WHO's demarcation and you are not required to memorize these countries. The max you can memorize is that 11 countries are in this region of WHO, okay. Now let's move forward. First of all, let's compare India and the world. So we have seen that over 6 lakh deaths were there, and out of those deaths, 1.7% is accounted by India. Okay, India is among the 11 high burden to high impact countries. Okay, now this 11 high burden to high impact is the name of the initiative that was launched by WHO in 2018 in order to eliminate malaria in the high impact countries by adopting a country-led approach. Now, what is the meaning of country-led approach? Country-led approach means the prioritizing the national needs first. What are the needs of India? What for needs in the sense that what do we need to eliminate malaria, and what is the geography, what are the cultural scenarios? So all of that, taking into consideration all of those things, we conclude country-led approach is best for eliminating malaria. Okay. So here we have the 11 countries, which also includes India. Now, if you look at these countries carefully, you will find 5 of the top 6 countries that I mentioned in the beginning table itself are here only. Okay, so obviously these are going to be the world's high burdened countries with malaria. Okay, so there is nothing much to memorize from here except for the fact that India accounts for 1.7% of global malarial deaths. Moving further, India and the high burden to high impact countries. So here is also a comparison. Now, isme aapko sirf itna yaad rakhna hai that India is the only country which has seen progress in reducing malaria in the HBHI grouping. Okay, except India, all the countries have seen an increase in the malarial cases. However, the rate of reduction of malarial cases in India has reduced in comparison to the rate that we were having before pandemic. Okay, so pandemic has reduced the rate of reduction, although we are in the positive side. Okay, now this point is not at all important for you. This is just for your understanding that these high burden, high impact countries are accounting for 67% of total cases and 71% of total malarial deaths worldwide. All of the data belongs to the year 2020. Do remember this thing as well. Now let's discuss the Southeast Asia. So again, here we have the numbers. Okay, total estimated cases in 2020, 5 million. What did I say to you in the beginning itself? Estimated is the estimate that how much would be the burden, because whenever we come to the ground reality, we are not able to track the total number of cases. However, in our minds and in our hearts, we know that the actual case load would be very much high. You can take the example of rapes in India also. The number of rapes that are recorded or reported and the actual reality. So both of them are different. So the number that is recorded is the reported or confirmed case, we can say. And the number that is not even recorded are the estimated burden. Similar is the case with this malaria. So 5 million, that is 50 lakh, is the estimated case in the entire Southeast Asia region. Do remember this thing. 8900 is the death rate, estimated again. Now 512,000 cases were reported or confirmed. So this is just the 10%. So you can see yourself that the reporting rate is very low. Now, what is the difference between these two? I've already told you what I wanted to say, that how is there a difference between the countries? Okay, so this point I will discuss a bit later when we will compare the countries in the Southeast Asian region, because there you will understand it better. Next point is total reported and confirmed deaths in 2020 is 147. Malaria-free countries in the Southeast Asia are Maldives and Sri Lanka. This is important point, guys. Do remember. Now, here are the highest burdened countries in the Southeast Asian region. India, Indonesia, Myanmar. Now, here, look at this thing. Estimated is 82.5%. Now, this means that in the entire Southeast Asia region that we have encountered first, India accounts for the highest number of malarial cases, 82.5%. Okay, so this is the estimate. But what is the actual number that we have recorded? It is 36.4%. On the other hand, we have Indonesia that has an estimated 15.6% contribution in the malaria burden of the Southeast Asian region. But the rate of recording is higher. It is the highest in the Southeast Asian nation. So we can say India and Indonesia has recorded the maximum number of cases in 2020 of malaria. So is this right? Is this actually the case? Is Indonesia the highest burdened country in the entire Southeast Asian region? No, guys, because the difference between the reporting is because of the healthcare facilities. It's because of the diagnosis facilities that we do not have properly. Okay, so that is the difference that is there in front of you. Next is Myanmar accounts for 1.6% of the cases in the entire Southeast Asian region, but when it comes to the actual recorded number, we have 11.5% contribution by Myanmar. Now let's come to deaths. So estimated 82% of all the estimated deaths in the entire Southeast Asian region is there in India. Okay, and actually the number that is recorded is 63%. Now you don't have to go into the details of this estimated number, because I did not find these numbers in the actual report of WHO, okay? And these are not very important from our exam point of view as well. Now, Indonesia has 22% record and Myanmar has 7% record. This shows that India has the highest record, we can say, the reported cases in terms of malarial deaths. But when it comes to reporting the or diagnosing the malarial victims, it is only 36.4%. This indicates that we need to increase the healthcare system so that diagnosis can be done quickly and treatment can be provided. Similar is the case with TB also, because we do not have sufficient diagnostic infrastructure. We lack in the TB notification. We do not get enough, or we can say the actual number of the TB patients in India. Similar is the case with malaria. And if we do not know the actual number of people who are suffering from the disease, how will the policymakers be able to provide them with the treatment? So this is basically a loop which needs to be fulfilled. And how will it be fulfilled? Once we have established the necessary healthcare infrastructure, okay? Now, what are the steps that India has taken to eliminate malaria? Nothing is written here. It's only the two initiatives. First is this policy, of India National Framework for Malaria Elimination 2016 to 2030. It was launched in 2016 almost. And it aims to eliminate malaria by 2030. India has joined this HBHI initiative, and according to India, I was reading one of the PIB releases. So there it was shown that after joining this initiative, which was launched in 2018 only, India has made significant progress in elimination of malaria. Okay. Next is that India is also a signatory to this declaration on accelerating and sustaining malaria elimination in the Southeast Asia region. Okay. So that's all about the World Malaria Report. Now guys, this is another question from the same report, and this question is basically to test your retention powers. So I have already taught you the target. You can read the question and pause the video, answer this question in order to test how much have you retained, and were you there in the video, was your mind here only or not. So this is just to test you. Okay, so here nothing is asked, just the global malaria mortality rate by 2030. What is the target that you have to mention? So moving on to the next question. Which country has assumed the vice chairmanship of Global Methane Initiative Steering Committee along with India? Germany, France, USA, Australia, Canada are in the options. The right answer here is USA. USA and India have been appointed as the vice chairs of this Global Methane Initiative Steering Committee. Now, basically, the steering committee is the policy making organ of this initiative. So, basically, steering committee is the karta dharta of this organization. So, the chair of this committee is Canada, vice chairs are India and USA. Now, what is the initiative all about? Clearly, from the name, it is evident that it is to reduce the anthropogenic methane emission. What is anthropogenic? Generated by humans. Okay, so in order to reduce methane emissions, this initiative was launched way back in 2004. Okay, right now I have told you the chair is Canada, vice chair is India and US. The secretariat which does all the implementation work is headed in is basically in Washington DC. It is hosted by the Environmental Protection Agency of the USA. Okay. Now, apart from this, there is nothing much on this question. Now, I would like to ask a question from you. Can you guys name the declaration that was adopted at COP26 in order to establish 6 green shipping corridors? Okay, can you guys name the initiative in the comment section below? So this is your question. Next question is, which bank has launched India's first loan facility against digital gold? Right answer is Shivalik Small Finance Bank. So again, there is nothing in detail about this news because you are not required to memorize too much of details of these kinds of insignificant news. I said insignificant because here by memorizing the facts only, you can easily retain these things. You can easily score good marks if a question comes from this news. So this Shivalik Small Finance Bank has launched India's first loan facility that will be given against the digital gold. Okay. So digital gold, I hope that all of you know. So this is another question for you all. What is digital gold? So I have written the very sophisticated definition. I would like to ask you to write it in a very layman's term. What is the digital gold exactly? Next question is, which company has received approval for supporting the tokenization of RuPay cards? So here guys, the right answer is PayFi. So PayFi has become the first certified tokenization service provider which has got the approval from NPCI for tokenizing the RuPay card. That is the entire news all about. Now, if you haven't read the tokenization guidelines of RBI, then you are supposed to do that. And for that, Tanvi ma'am has created a video on our channel only. So you can go and search for the video RBI 247 tokenization and you will get the video. Understand what tokenization is all about. Next question is, who is the present Secretary General of International Institute for Democracy and Electoral Assistance? So here the right answer is option D, Kevin Casas Zamora. So he is the present Secretary General. And what is the news? Sunil Arora, who was our former election commissioner, has been appointed as an advisor, has joined the board of advisors of this organization. Okay, so that's the news. Now, what is this organization? This organization basically aims to promote democracy across the world. So it was established in 1995, headquartered in Stockholm, Sweden. At present, we have 34 countries as members of this organization. And Secretary General is Kevin Casas Zamora. Okay, the board to which Sunil Arora has been elected has 15 members. So here, guys, this video ends. If you liked the content provided by us, then do subscribe to the channel, like this video, share it among your friends. Thank you so much for watching the video.